Hi everyone, welcome to It's Shader Day. So I will try to host live stream every Saturday. Feedback. Just to prove it's working. Alright, so my name is Gaëtan Renaudot and I will host Shader Day, which will be about writing a shader every day. But in this live stream, I will write it every week. And basically, let me share my screen. So here is the context a bit. In France, we have a second lockdown with the coronavirus. So I decided to do something special. The first lockdown, I didn't do anything. But this time, I say okay. Ask to myself, what could I do? And one thing I could do is actually write a shader, a OpenGL shader every day. And that's what I started. So I started a bit this trend on Twitter so far. So every day I was just writing a shader, simple stuff. So yeah, different effects essentially. I will try in this video to first go through what really a shader is about. And once I introduce that, I will just dive into trying to write one today. And every time when I do this, I start a bit from scratch. I don't really know where I'm going, but I just explore stuff. And that's what I did. I explored different things, as you can see here. So here we have a Game of Life effect, but using a polar coordinates instead of Cartesian coordinates. So it's give an interesting effect. Then I went into a bit more interesting stuff, like doing actual 3D stuff. This is using sine distance functions that I will try to explain. And that's what is really interesting in the demo scene right now. You can do a lot of crazy 3D effects. So I went a bit into the hexagon. So yeah, I did all of this the past days. And yeah, that's what I did last Saturday. And I will see what today will be about. I'm not sure. I have some ideas, but we'll see. And yeah, I explored various effects, just playing with simple sine distance functions. So yeah, let's dive into it. So I'm hosting the One Day One Shader website, which looks like this. So that was the last shader we had. So yeah, let's dive into that. Just before we start, my name is Gaëtan Renaudot, as I said, and I'm the creator also of GL React, which basically brings the GL effects into a React paradigm. So you write some GSX, you write some classical React components, and it just allows you to do WebGL in that, and essentially you can compose effects, which is quite interesting. You can do effects over effects over effects. In GS6 paradigm. I also worked at Ledger, which is also really interesting. So we are doing hardware wallets for securing Bitcoin and other coins. Anyway, not much about me. Let's just dive into some concepts. So what is remarching and remarching sine distance functions? So When you want to represent a 3D, you have different ways, and the classical ways will be to define objects of your scene. What is your scene? You define some cubes, you define some sphere, you give them some global position, and you render that. But there is another paradigm, another way to think about objects, is just to define a function that gives a sine distance. So given like the distance of the closest object. So essentially, for any point in the 3D environment, for any x, y, and z, you have to give a value, the distance to the closest object. And that's what a sine distance function is. And how do you actually render that kind of function, which is quite basic, in fact, in a canvas? And you actually do remarching. So remarching is the algorithm. Sine distance function is just the concept. And yeah, essentially, a lot of demo scene videos are based on that, and just composing, and it's just math essentially. So you compose more and more things, and then at some point you get a crazy demo. So that's a bit the goal. And here are some theories. So yeah, I really like this article. If you want to check it out, you have the URL here. But basically, it gives a bit the concepts, explain it, and here it's just saying how to render a sphere. So what is the distance to a sphere? It's basically this formula. And when you put that into actual code, into a language called DLSL, which this live stream is going to write, I mean, OpenGL and WebGL use that language. That runs on the graphic card, essentially. Anyway, in that language, you can express it that way, and it's pretty simple. So the length of a vector 3, so x, y, and z, is actually going just to be that formula, right? And just removing a number, that number is the radius of your sphere. So that gives the distance to that sphere. And how does remarching works how do you actually render something out of it? So you have to think the rectangle of your screen as an array of pixels, and essentially for each pixel you have to throw an array. So you have a camera, you have your rectangle, and you throw an array through that for each pixel. And then you get some information. So essentially, and that's explained a bit here, the remarching algorithm is just working by starting with the initial point, using the distance of the closest object, moving to that distance, because that's the best move you can do, and then doing it again. So it's a loop, basically, until you reach a distance that is small enough. So quite simple, and that's quite simple to write as well. And you get some effects. So let's just try with some code. So I'm gonna go to some code. All right, so let's actually make a new effect, a new day. I don't know which, I guess I can start with one of the first demo I had, which I guess this one was quite simple. I can start from this one. Just gonna duplicate it to, so today is gonna be the 16th. All right. So here is my scene, essentially. So as I said, we are in React, and using GL React, I use a node, so that's a primitive in the React world, and you give a shader. You give a shader that takes a time as an input, and my time is just going to, that component is going to be rendered at 60 frames per second, essentially, with giving the time. And then you have this language, GLSL, that's what we see here. Here we have a lot of code because that's the demo I had the other day. But essentially you look at that part, that's where the main function is, and that's what is getting called for each pixel of your screen, of your canvas. So I'm just gonna actually comment some code here, just to show you that starting simple, we could write something like that. UV. So we have some global like parameters of that shader that's defined here. We only have two. We have the time, and we also have the position of the screen, UV. And it's moving from 0 to 1 on the X axis and as well on the Y axis. So I could just go, because here I have to give a color, that's what the shader is going to do. And I can just give the X into the red component and the Y into the green component. And the opacity is gonna be 1. So that's the classical shader, I mean the classical image I like to use, so that's what we see here as well. Anyway, that's the most simple shader you can think of. And we already did something a bit interesting because it's already like a bidirectional gradient. But yeah, obviously you could just use one direction to make a unidirectional one. Anyway, that's quite simple stuff. What else can you do? You could use the length, as we just saw before. The length of a vector is just going to be, in my case here, it's going to be a radial gradient. If I would want to make it center, I will have to offset the position. So essentially what you see here is we have a bunch of primitives in that language. You can do operation on vectors. I mean, you have actually vectors in the first place. You have some native types, vectors, matrix. Yeah, that's quite interesting and made for the purpose of doing some math. And you have cosinus, you have all the math, classical functions, you can do modulus, you can do a bunch of operations, even on vectors. And here, if I could control a bit the density of my gradient, the start and stop position, that's where we essentially can do a lot of things. And obviously I can play with times as well. You can, cosinus of the time, it's just going to start animating something. All right, so I just want to show you also another primitive which is important to know. That's the step primitive. So in classical, I like to say that this language is more closer to math than programming languages. You don't do ifs, you try to avoid doing ifs, and you have another primitive. Instead of doing ifs, you just use step. Step is a function with two parameters, and it's going to return 0 or 1 depending on if the A is below or higher than the X, the second parameter. And saying that, we could start trying to make a circle by just using the same, instead of having the length as a, because it have a variation of value, I'm just gonna pipe it into step. And if I want a circle of 1, except this shouldn't be multiplied, but because 1 is the full canvas, so a circle of the radius, the total width is 1, but the radius is 0.5. That controls the radius essentially. and yeah, we can play a lot of with a lot of things starting on that. There's an important, I think what's also interesting as a primitive is a function called smooth step. It's already a bit more advanced, but if you take a look, a close look here on the edge, it might not be that smooth, and you could do something like that. Yeah, so if I want to blur a bit my edges, I could use a smooth step, for instance. Smooth step is just going to... It's a bit an evolution of step, but essentially you give a range of value, and it's going to project 0 if you are below that, and 1 if you are above that, and all the values between are going to be more or less linear. It's not exactly linear, it's actually a bit smoother on the edges. You can search for smooth step, you can take a look at the curves, but essentially it's making things a bit more nice. If you guys have any question in the live stream, I am watching it, so don't worry, don't hesitate. Otherwise, I'm just gonna continue, and I'm gonna show you now a bit more advanced things. I'm gonna go back to my SDF, my remarching of my distance function, and okay, let's go back to that code. And let's try to understand what's happening here. So as we said, we start with a camera, and the camera is going to be located in the 3D space. So you have to start with a point. That's actually the point you are going to throw as a ray. And since my function is actually called for each pixel of my canvas, I'm already one ray. I already focus on one ray, and I will try to throw my ray, and as soon as I hit an object, until I hit an object, I have to continue forward, and when I hit that object, I need to give a color for that object, essentially. So here we can see we have a normalize function. Essentially, normalizing is going just to do this camera projection, and it's doing it on the z-axis, I think. Yeah, that's why I position myself a bit behind the z, and I just look forward z. That's what this logic is doing here. But I could use rotate, right? Rotate is multiplying to a matrix, and I can show you that a bit later. I think I'm using it here. So yeah, that's the rotation, you can express it like this. So anyway, let's dive into that. So we have a loop here, and in that loop we call the sine distance function that gives us a distance. And when I reach to, as we saw on the algorithm I shared just before, until we reach a distance that is small enough, we continue. And if we actually almost touch that object, we are just going to break, so we have finished our remarching. And here there's already a lot of trade-offs here. I mean, 16, why 60 and not more? That's essentially going to impact the performance, but if I don't put enough, I'm not gonna see all objects, I'm not gonna reach them. If I put too much, it's going to be super intense for my CPU, and I already have a FP, like 20 FPS, yeah, 15 FPS right now on my stream because the CPU is quite intense. So I just go back to, yeah, it's back to 30 FPS. So yeah, it's not meant for performance in a way, because it's quite the opposite of what you would do in if you want to do a performance game. You wouldn't do that. You would probably have more optimized way to do things instead of doing a one big shader, because that's what you need to understand, is like this shader is spread over your canvas, which is actually not what it's meant to be done in classical 3D. You actually will do it on polygons. So each polygon will run a shader in an optimized world. But this is really interesting for math and for experimenting. Doesn't GLSL work on GPU instead of CPU, you mean? Oh yeah. So indeed, you are right. My GPU was a bit burning, but you are right. You are right. And the fact I stream on is actually using the GPU as well. So yeah, there is it's the GPU. You are right. Sorry, I was misleading. All right. So here we can see the piece that's the algorithm we saw before as well. Your ray needs to progress every time, so you are marching, so you are throwing your ray until that is reached. Here, as I said, there is trade-offs, and one of the trade-offs is to say my the color is going to use like the eye is interesting because that's the number of iterations you do, and more you do iteration, probably like far is the object. Yeah. So essentially, here there's what I did here is just saying that I will use that to give the color between white and black. I use that eye as a way to color my object. Another way would be, and maybe that's something I will explore today, I don't know, but there is another way to use you want to know what is I forget the term, sorry, but essentially the vector that is orthogonal to your object, the normal vector. You probably want to use that as a way to give a color for the object, because, and that's actual physics, like when you have a light, it's going to be lighter if your light is just behind your object, but if it's on the side, it's going to be a bit darker. So you could multiply, do the dot product of your ray, of your, the ray of your light with the normal vector of your object. So if I have like an object like this, like a Scala cup, my normal vector is going to be pointing at the octagonal direction, pointing up the object. And using that, you can do better shading of your object. Yeah, we don't have shadows, it's quite basic. But anyway, I that's already enough of to already render something. And I'm also using the Z of essentially the distance of the object with the camera. I'm using that as a way to fade the objects that are far away. So everything is said here, there is not a lot of logic, but obviously if you want to do more interesting rendering, you will have to bring more and more concepts and more iterations to do shadows, to do reflections, to do better lighting. So yeah, a lot of things will have to be built up on top of that. But the concept remains the same. The concept of this function that gives the distance of my closest object is the same. Let's go back to the simplest distance function. As we saw before, that's the sphere. So if I just return the length of P, it's not gonna do anything because it's just a dot, the length of my... So I need to give a radius, and that's what I do here. So a radius of one of my sphere is quite small because I'm quite far away here. So I can approach a bit closer. So that's it. We already have a sphere. It's not easy to perceive the 3D aspect of it. Probably due to the fact I use shade as a way to color it. but that's okay. I think we can continue forward. So let's look at other primitives. There is a important like a really awesome person IQ in the Demosphere scene is doing a lot of article, a lot of explanation on what we can do with this paradigm, and he has defined in this page a lot of primitives that you can use that defines the distance for different kind of objects, quite classical objects. So you have a box, and I'm not sure I got it here. No, I didn't import it yet, so I can just take this and so it takes two parameters, still my p, so you always have to give the position of your ray, and then it's just gonna be the dimension of the box. So I guess I can make also instead of a square, I could do different shapes. Just starting with a square, we see just a square. We don't see a 3D object here. That's just because, and yeah, there is my head here. I think I need to move myself because I'm hiding the thing. Yep. All right. So I need to rotate because here it's. We are pointing at the Z, and the box itself is also just gonna be on that same axis. So to do that, there is different approaches. I think in that case, I have a rotate function. So what I can try is rotate on an axis. So rotation in 3D can be done by multiplying with the matrix, and usually you use a matrix of 3 by 3. Sometimes there's even using a 4 by 4 because you can express also translations. But an approach to do that is actually to just do it in 2D. So a rotation in 2D is just using it's a simple formula you can find on Wikipedia, but basically it's just cosinus, sinus, minus sinus, and cosinus. So you can apply this concept in 3D as well by just focusing on one plan. So here I just use the XY plan, meaning I will rotate on the Z axis. And I multiply my matrix. Is it called rot? Yeah. And I need to give an angle. So yeah, I can just give the time and that's done. I mean, I have my rotation on the Z axis. Still not really, still not satisfying because I don't see my 3D shape. Are you rotating the object or the camera? So that's a good question. And every time, it's a bit mind-blowing because essentially you could reuse the P to you're a bit lost in thinking what am I already rotating, but I think you are actually rotating your position, so you are rotating your ray. Yeah, it's like you are in somewhere in the 3D world, in the 3D space, and you transform yourself into another position. So I think you are actually rotating your ray, so it's not really the object, and that's why. So here, if I just move my X, my X is going to be the X on the screen. So here I remove one, and actually I'm moving to the right. So that's because my ray is moving to the left, that my object is actually moving to right. So you are moving your camera in a way, but more your ray, because the ray is actually moving. If that makes sense. So yeah, obviously I can move in Y, I can move in X, and the Z is going to be the distance with the camera. So here it was not really interesting. Obviously, it's just the z-axis. But if I, so here it's, as I said, really powerful language. We can do sub. We can do a transformation on part of the vector 3. So I could do x. I could do x y. I could do even this kind of like that's built in the language. So x z. Alright, so now we see something interesting. And yeah, I can do it again, I can do a second rotation, and it's going to be like a bit interesting. I just wonder if is this really real 3D, like I feel there is a small deformation, but I'm not sure. Anyway, that's interesting. So that's the basics. What's interesting now is we can also combine objects. I mean, here I just have a cube. What if I want a cube and a sphere? So let's take a look at that. So here what we said is essentially my cube is that, and I return my cube. So the cube float is the distance to the cube given a position in sphere, in the space, sorry. But now I can also do a sphere, so I think I wrote this as a function. Sphere. Yeah, S. So I didn't really return it, but if I would, I would just get the sphere. So there is two ways there's different style code and there's like many ways you could achieve things. You could also inline a translation here. If I don't want to touch the actual initial P, I could inline it like this. So there is a basic way to do. Essentially, let's say I want to both render cube and the sphere at the same time. What would be the component to do that? What would be the way to do that? So what? And you have to think what is the closest object to myself if I have a sphere and a box next to each other. What is the closest distance to these two objects as a whole? Then essentially, it's the mean. So you take the mean, the minimal distance between the sphere and your cube. And that's an union. So that's how you define doing an union. And you have different ways to... You have essentially, like in math, you can do union, difference, intersections. You can do the same. You can do the same in this paradigm. So if instead of mean, I use max, this is going to be an intersection. And if I want to do a difference, I can do it like this. That's the simplest way you can think of implementing them. That's also defined in, that's also explained in that article at the end, I believe, as part of all the nice primitives I gave. Octahedron, yeah, nice. I want to play with something like a pyramid, maybe, just after. Yeah, what's interesting is you can also... you can also exclude, whatever you... I don't remember the term, but essentially you can... you have a 2D object and you elongate it. Extrude, I guess that's the word. So that's where it's defined. And there is also more interesting ways that you can do it in a smooth way, meaning that it's not a raw edges, like it's not just a strict union, but you can have it a bit rounded. So really, really interesting. So I think it's almost exactly the example I gave anyway. So you give that, you can see the result we have. Yeah, I just want to quickly show you the fact you can do repetition quite easily. So it's not really efficient in classical graph scene way. If you want to repeat a cube, you actually repeat the cube and you have a big array of objects, and it's not possible to do it infinitely. I mean, it's the memory is limited. So, but in this paradigm, you can do it for free, essentially, except you are probably going to do more loops in that remarching, but that's the only limitation it will have. You can do it by using a modulus. And I think I'm gonna do something that will not work, but still gonna try. So mod is in programming, sometimes you have a percentage used for that, but basically it's a mod function. So if I do my x mod modulus 10, it's going to be always the return value of that is going to be between 0 and 10, and it's going to repeat. If that makes sense, but I guess it's easy to see if you. I don't know if this website have a modulus. Yeah, so if I do 10, it's just going to look like this. So for a given x, it's always going to be between 0 and 10, and it's going to linearly climb like that. So here it's just going to do shit, I think. Yeah, so you see my object is cut, his eyes glitches. Obviously, because I'm not well centered here, I need to offset. Is it a plus or a minus? I guess it's a minus. So here I just write it in place, but yeah. So yeah, so every object are distanced by 10. They are a bit far away. Can move my camera a bit behind. Yeah, and it's I don't really like this rotation, but anyway, that's good enough to test things. I can approach a bit more my objects by a distance of 4. I can go back to the union. So yeah, you get the concept. And obviously you can just, I don't know if this works. Yeah, I think this can work on like that. So yeah, like already got something interesting. So simple stuff. That's what the op rep is implemented here is doing. So yeah, I think in another shader I used it a few times, but I used another variation of that function instead of oprep. Let me check. There is another, because usually it's not enough. If you want to color something, each object differently, you will need some kind of identifier to know what index of the object is, which is what I did in my one of the other demo I used. So the problem here is like this function is just giving you back the position, the value, but not actually saving in memory what is the ID. I can do a hack here by having a global variable and put it inside it. But anyway, there's another way, which let me check that. So I don't remember the name. There is a really interesting material I sometimes use. I forget. Anyway, there's some interesting primitive, and normally I should every time I use something from outside, I will try to link it. So, I mean, I'm not inventing the whole thing. There's a huge demo scene, a lot of crazy people like doing super awesome stuff. I'm just a small kid in that world, playing with things. So I think, yeah, I think that was it. SD. Where is my mouse? Where is my mouse? that's nice. I don't have no longer. Okay. Okay, I need to change my battery. Hold on. We'll be back shortly. All right. Alright, anyway, that's okay. I don't remember where I put that other one. Oh yeah, that was a few days ago, I guess. That's why I guess that's here. Yes, that's one. So it's another version of the modulus, a bit more evolved here. I can try it. Instead of a one-liner like that, like this one, in fact, because it's just doing it on one axis. I just will put the two functions to compare it. So what you see here is you have an in-out operator here. That means what you do in that function, if you assign P again, it's actually going to be assigned on the other side. So it's like a pointer and actually modifying the content of P. So that means it's a bit less functional. It's not a pure function, but I mean, that's like an output. That's the return value is going to be assigned again on the other side. But here it's interesting because the return value is actually a value from 0 to I guess it's 0, 1, 2, 3, so the index of the object. Yes, that's it, because we divide by the size. Yeah. So just gonna try that. Where is it? Okay, I have too many functions, I will remove that. Oh yeah, that's the smooth one. I'm just gonna use it, smin. So yeah, it's smoother. So instead of doing this mod in place, I can just modulate on X. It's too close. So the same. So here I didn't assign myself the P again, so it's like an operator that actually mutates. In a way, it mutates my P. But here I can return, I mean, I can get n. And use that for doing things differently, like I could, using the Y. X is my repetition, so I can put that in a Y. And yeah, I've made my sphere going out of the box, basically. So I can use that for different purposes. I can also, if I want another coloring, I would use that for coloring differently. So there is different ways I could return the information that of my like the object ID or something like that. First approach would be to use a vector 2 and I put both my distance and more information as the return value. That's one way. Another hack, it's a bit hacky, more hacky, but I can actually put my variable outside, assign it here, and since I break on the first and I only do one for loop, there is no different iteration of SDF, it's going to be fine in my case. And I can use it here in some ways. I don't know how, but I just modulate the just messing with stuff just to try. Yeah, so it's change between the objects. And usually you don't really want to do that yourself. I mean the color, trying to figure out the color. You can try to use some interesting functions like the palette, which is also defined by IQ. He published something really interesting, a function that give for a given value between 0 and 1. It gives the color in a palette, so in a I guess I can find it here. Procedural color palette, and he used it for a bunch of demos. But essentially, it looks like this. The basic one is this one. You have all the colors available, but you can use different variation of a palette. And by using that, it's easier to play with because RGB is not really easy. It's not really. It's like the worst paradigm, I think. In sometimes when you do demos, RGB is really not great. It's really hard to think to have different variations of a color in RGB. It's not easy. You have a better, I think, paradigm like HSV, for instance, is much easier to play with. But this one gives an interesting idea because you can, for a given X, you can pick a color, and depending on your palette, obviously. But anyway, that's I think what I did in many of the demos, like this one. Every time I was using that palette. Here as well, that's just an easy way to achieve that. All right, so I think I'm not running out of time, but I think I'm spending too much time and just not writing my shader yet. So let's actually write something and I will try to do something interesting. I think I will need my palette. I will try to gather everything I need. So okay, I guess I can start with that simple logic we had so far. Why not just having a simple palette for now? I think I can take the palette of one of these. Yeah, maybe this one. So I have my palette. So that's the function, one line function for generating any kind of palette. And here is just one specific palette I had. I think I can go back to the basic palette, which I think is that one. Just for now. So do I still have my N? Yeah. Color. So So it's a value, it's still going to be, it's going to be 0, 1, 2, 3, so it's not, it's always 0 because it's modulus 1, so it's not showing anything interesting. But if I divide it by 4, I guess I will have a repetition every 4, yeah, every... I can put 8. So yeah, that's nice because you have a variation. One thing I wanted to say also on the repetition idea, like this modulus, and there is an important problem, I would say, in the remarching approach, is that when we do modulus, we are actually a bit breaking the paradigm, because we are not truly, if you push it too far to the edges, basically the objects moving close to the edges, you are going to probably have glitches. Here we don't really have them, but yeah, here we can see some glitches. Like when the camera is moving, we see the edges are like doing weird things. That's because it's not an exact distance. So yeah, if you want to dig more into that, feel free to read this article, but yes, some objects are giving a true distance to the object, some are not, so some are not exact, which give you can give you pretty bad glitches if you push it too far. And for instance, you can let's try, you can modulate a bit the transform a bit, like having some using cos and sinus on the x and y, you can do a blobby weird effects. If you push it too far, you can really mess things. Maybe let's try. We're just gonna do a translation on x, but using cosinus of actually the x. Whoa, nice. Let's move closer. So I think I'm close to the edge still here. So that's why I just want to get rid of the modulus for now, because I don't really need it. So I can modulate the frequency, and yeah, you see, like I mean technically cool, we see the idea, it's like a sine wave in 3D, but if you push it too far, what's happening here is your ray, the ray you throw is actually traversing your objects sometimes, because the distance was wrong. I mean, the distance was saying maybe 10, and it's actually 9, and then your ray is like going too far. There is a hack to solve a bit that. I actually wonder if that 0.5 is actually that, but if I move a bit less than the actual distance, I'm going to have less of these glitches. But the trade-off is I will need more iteration of the loop, because I'm not moving to the distance, I'm moving to a bit less than the distance. So I try to not traverse my object at the end, but the initial problem is my distance is wrong. So this effect is fine if you don't push it too far, basically. And yeah, you can do nice things. You can do it on Z. What did I just do? Why is it doing this? Why is it so black? I don't know. Okay, try different parameters. I mean, yeah, that's a bit how I sometimes the demo I will just try random things like that, try to get an interesting effects, but sometimes I start with something more concrete. So let's start with something more concrete. I had two ideas today, but with the time I have, I think I will just explore one. I wanted to try to give a try today to what is it called? The Relo triangles. It's an interesting object, and I wanted to give a try of implementing it. It has really interesting properties, like when it rotates, it always has the same width. So if you put it in a square, it's always going to touch the edges, but never going further. And it's used in it's in French article. The article is in French, but that's the same. And the way to implement it is just the intersection. So yeah, we can do it easily. We know how to do intersections. So intersection of three circles, and you have a 3D version of that, which is called. That's why I was saying triangle is interesting, because I want a pyramid. Actually, it's not a pyramid. It's a tetrahed. I have to go back to the French article because it's better. Yeah, so tetrahedral, whatever it's called in English, but essentially you have this. It's not a pyramid; it's a tetrahed, and you have to that the center of your of the sphere is going to be on each. Corner of the tetrahed. Okay, so I don't know exactly how I would like to use it at the end, but yeah, I think I want to try it out and see what I can do in terms of I would like to do an infinite effect, like infinite fractal animation, like it's looping, infinite loop. I don't know. Let's try how we can do it. We'll see. All right. Ooh. Okay, so we'll need to define. I can just kill this. I want a. How is it called? Tetrahed. Okay, relo. SD relo. Okay, I guess that's enough. I will have to implement that. I could give a size, I guess, but that's okay. I can. Oh, that's still interesting, I think. Let's give a size. There's two ways you could do size. You can actually scale the vector itself, but. It's a bit harder, I guess, to manipulate such a... Alright, so that was the box. So it's a... I don't know if I have a primitive for doing a union, but it's a max. So max of three spheres, three circles, or four spheres if I do it in 3D. What should I do, 3D or 2D? I don't know. I mean, I can actually do an extrusion of the object itself. Would be easier for making an infinite effect. Okay, let's try the triangle first. Yeah, but the thing is, actually, it's maybe easier to. Okay, let's just play. Yeah, I think I want to use one another primitive which do the extrusion. If I do that. But maybe for now I can just use spheres and see how it looks like. Okay, so I have a center. Okay, so essentially I need a triangle like that. I don't have the formula in my head about how to write a triangle, but essentially the center I can rotate on a specific angle, 60, yeah, I think it's 60, no, 1, yeah, we'll see. But it's 2 pi divided by 3. I don't have pi, and that's not a built-in constant in the language, so I will do it like that. I mean, I can do a loop, but that's a bit overkill. Yeah, I don't know where to start. I could use the repetition. Yeah, I could use that. I think I have an interesting component somewhere that allows to repeat. Yeah, that one. And that's where I was not remembering where I grabbed that. But it's really important. Yeah, that one. Mercury. So this website and this is from a demo singer who did a really interesting demo and he shared a lot of operators. He shared a lot of things. There's even more, much more advanced stuff. And what was really interesting is you have a version of mod that also can be stopped, can be bounded, and you have the polar version of doing modulus. That's what I want to use, because I will just do it in a street. I want to project my sphere in three places. Why was this really important? Yeah, it have a different approach for doing smooth as well, I think, and you can, and it's actually written in this paradigm where you give for the modulus at least, you get an ID out of it, so you can do something with the index, which usually you might want, so. So, and yes, it's quite simple, it's just a function, and you give the P. I'm not modifying the correct function. Correct file. So you give a P, which is your position, and you give how much you repeat. So 3. In my case, if I do a sphere right now, it's just going to be 3 times the same sphere because I didn't translate it yet. I think I need to translate after, in fact. I first do the modulus, then an x move by one, by size, I don't know. That's a good question. Maybe size, let's put size everywhere, but I don't know what is the size of... What is the formula between the... What is the radius of the sphere? Oh, that's gonna be interesting to figure this out. Yeah, let's try. Let's mess a bit with it first. Simple stuff, just return the circle. What's going on? Oh, it's a VEC2. Yeah, indeed. Yeah, so I want to do it on I guess XZ. What? Ah. Oh yeah, Z is actually my wrong axis, I guess. I mean, I can run it in different axes. All right, so that's give a sphere. That's the union of spheres. Oh, actually, the radius of the sphere is the edge of the triangle itself. But the way I did it is not... I don't really easily know the edge. I need to multiply by something. Do the math. With some trigonometry, anyway. Yeah, it can't work. Modulus can't work within this paradigm. Because I want to do a mass. Oh, it's not gonna be that easy. Yeah, all right. I mean, in fact, I could hard code some translation of my spheres. I just need to calculate them. So if I say my distance is actually the... I need to put that on paper. That's cosinus of... Right. I will have three spheres, A, B, and C. So I'm in the middle, and I. So first of all, the position of the. Of the first circle is easy. It's just I'm in the middle, so it's plus the size on x. on Y, sorry. Sphere, no matching overload. Oh yeah, the size. I don't know what the size is as well. That's the edge of the okay. Which we'll need because we need to know the edge. What is the edge? That's a good question. If you have the answer on the chat, I'm happy to know because otherwise I will have to figure it out. But anyway, that's my radius because here we see the radius is the edge of this triangle. It seems like I want to minus. So in X, it's clear. If I'm in the middle, I move left by half of the edge. That's easy. And minus. And that's one I don't really easily know. It's actually the only part. Yeah, I need to calculate two things, this value and the edge. This value is how much I go down from the middle. It's half. It's half it's half of the 8 here, and that's cosinus of I think it's easy. Right, let's call it h. That's the 8 of my triangle essentially. H. I think it's it's not working. Okay. Yeah. It's okay, but it's not. Yeah, obviously it's not. Okay, I don't really know what edge is yet. I can't figure out if it's this or I need to do the math. It's something. I can't figure out the math. Hold on. Just gonna oh my god, I'm so that's yeah, so it's okay. Square root 3 divided by 2. We just approximate that value. Oh, it's already a built-in thing. Wow. But it's 3 we need. Okay, yeah. What is this? I think you can do it with Pi. With cosinus. I don't. Oh, yeah, yeah. No. Anyway. Lost. Okay, yeah, I was close. The problem is I was not divided by two because I need to need half of the 8. Actually it's divided by 2 here. So I got it wrong. I got it right here, like this. Nope. Oh yeah, but what is? That's not the edge. Size is not the edge. Size is the full size. So the same size needs to be a bit lower. And this one is a bit tough too. Oh yeah, actually that's the same. Actually, I think that's gonna be this factor anyway. Not really. Does not look right. Oh, I feel shameful. Oh, thanks. Radius is an equilateral. Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Oh, divided by square. Of 2, okay. Square of 3, sorry. I think that looks better, but edge is wrong. It's still wrong. I mean, why am I doing it like that? Size. Actually, the size is my radius. I mean, yeah. The edge is my radius. That's a okay, and actually that I lost myself. That's a disaster. I actually wonder if this one is correct or not. What am I doing? What am I doing? I don't. All right, that looks okay. I think my mass is wrong, but that looks okay. I think it's interesting if we rotate. That again. Okay, it's not. I mess up the center, I think. I messed up the center. Maybe it's a plus here. Yeah, it is. And I guess that's why all my calculation was wrong, because again, I think that should be that. H is the 8th Oh no, sorry, you said radius. Yeah, okay, that's the radius, okay. Too far. I think I'm moving too. Yeah. All right. Did someone did the math somewhere for me? Yeah. Okay. That's giving the area. Don't need that. The translation is easy, in fact. The translation is easy, but the part is what is the radius of the sphere? Oh, wait, is that the edge? Yeah, we said it before. Okay, just going back. Edge is the radius. I mean, I can say this is the edge, and that's it. That's the edge of my triangle. That's it. So I actually give the edge, and then. Still need to figure out the 8. So the 8 was the edge time divided by 2, or sinus of sinus of. Okay, that's it. Yeah, I don't know where I went at some point, but it's still not center, though. So. Looks alright, but yeah, the center, I need to, yeah, obviously. The center of a triangle, it's not actually really the center of the 8, the height. It's a bit, yeah, it's a bit lower, I think it's, yeah, there is this. Yeah, it's already a union of spheres, and I could rotate a bit on the which axis. What's going on? Oh, yeah. On the x axis. Let's check. Wow. Yeah, because, indeed. That's interesting. So if I put a third, a fourth, like a the sphere number five, number four. I don't know how to say that. Fourth sphere. I will actually get the 3D form of the triangle, which is explained in the. Yeah. I will get that. So I will need a third version. But if I stay in 2D, I could just have a plan that cuts in the middle and extrude that. So yeah, the center is not what I thought, so I will have to offset a bit my Y. And I'm not sure by what. Yeah, that's pretty straightforward here. Yeah, that's what I thought it was. I had that in mind. 2 divided by 3 is the ratio. Yeah, makes sense. I think. So. Why divided by 6? Minus. I think that's it, I'm not sure. Need to make it really fast. it looks like it. No, it's not. It's moving. No. Yeah, 1 divided by 3. I'm not sure. We don't need to be pixel perfect. We can cheat a bit. That thing that looks okay. Oh, it's hard to see. I think I need to put an object that. Yeah. Or just hack with that trick, maybe. That's not what I wanted to do. What? Oh, never mind. Mix my color between that and boom. Yeah, like that sounds good. Sounds good. All right, we have our shape defined. What will be the if we want to make this 3D shape? I guess I use the same height, so the same H. And I would just need to do a D and move it on the Z. But I'm going to be offset as well on Z. Yeah, I will have to offset, I can offset Z. And what's what's interesting is we could actually do it in 3D, not in 2D, that's okay. It's not centered, and I don't really have the proof yet that it worked. Looks like it worked, but yeah, just remove that. No, I should be centered, I think. Yeah, I'm not centered, that's what I said, okay. But the shape is nice, it seems to be the correct formula. So it was not that bad, I just didn't figure out that part yet, at first. Okay, so Z needs to... I think it's the same, maybe not. No, it's, I think it's 6666. But wait, I'm supposed to multiply by edge, I think. So initially I was saying one out of six, because that's what the offset was, and that makes sense because the edge is two. Actually, here it's divided by 3. Doesn't look like it's centered. Maybe I am on the opposite one. Nope. Wrong guess. It's not easy to tell, but I will expect the edge will always touch the same. I mean, it should be contained in a cube. So yeah, I could have the bounding cube, as you said. And play with that. I mean, if I do the intersection, they should be known. If I do the union, if I do the difference, there should be no glitches, no problem, yeah. But I will need to make the cube not rotate, because right now everything is rotating. What I can put that in the function, the rotation, I can put it in the function. Or I can just keep another variable. I dropped, it's here, box. What should be the... We define the edge, so it's not actually the 8. Yeah, the 8 is defined by this. Is it the bounding? It's not the actual bounding, it's a bit more. Yeah, it's twice the radius. Radius is the edge. So yeah, it's actually the radius of the whole shape. Meaning my box should be twice that, I think. Oh no, but the box is already defined in some sort of radius. It's like half of the, yeah. All right, should be two. Return. Syntax error. Yeah, I didn't return it. Nope. Oh yeah, why is it doing that? Yeah, it's half. But then that's not the radius. Edge. If I rotate that, zoop, yeah, it's gonna be not exactly the... Alright, well, let's see. Hey William, so glad to have you here. Yeah, we are trying to figure out things. I'm messing with math. Oh my god, you lost an hour or something. But anyway, the goal is I'm trying to make a triangle de relieu triangle, but actually more this object in 3D. So messing around, and I already got it implemented, but I'm trying to figure out if it's actually centered. And that's not easy to tell. But if it's contained in a box, obviously it's gonna contain in the projection of that box, which is our canvas. So basically the shape shouldn't go out of the canvas. That's one way to see it. And here it's moving. Oh no, okay, that's nice. But is it centered though? I don't know. Oh lala. Anyway, let's do more. Okay, we have our shape. It's nice. Now let's try something out. Initially, I said I wanted to have some kind of infinite loop animation, like some kind of fractal, and then it needs to get back to the initial state. I was seeing something really interesting a few hours ago. I'm not logged in. I cannot even see my following if I'm not logged in. Anyway, there is a lot of nice fractals, nice infinite effects, infinite loop and things like that. So I wonder if I should make the triangle itself going in splitting itself into different parts. Oh, that's... Oh, actually, can I make another triangle inside to make like the Zelda logo and split my triangle? But it's not a triangle, it's this object. Can it be split? If I make a smaller version of it, it's not gonna have the same curve, so it doesn't work. It cannot be split in a nice way. Like it cannot be. But it has other properties. The fact it's contained in a box, so it's an interesting object. Yeah. Which is nice because if it's contained in a box, then my the repeat stuff I used before actually is never going to be moving out of that repetition. Yes, so I can actually repeat with the same way. Would it be two? Yeah, maybe cosinus of the time, so it's not going in all angles. Whoops. think I misplaced that. Wait. Okay. Seems like it works. Thanks. Wait. Oh, yeah, so we see the problem of... What do we actually see? Yeah, I think we see the problem I was mentioning before, the fact it's not true distance. There is glitches because the algorithm of the remarching wouldn't work. Or maybe my object is too big. But then it wouldn't be centered, so... Yeah, it's not centered. It's not centered. Is it just... Oh yeah, let's move them all. Let's rotate them all. So, push it back to... Yeah, so on the bottom... On the bottom, it doesn't glitch, and on the top, it glitches. So, meaning it's not centered, I think. But is it really my Z? Yeah. Okay. The Y is rotated. Okay, I need to rotate in different ways because different speed. No, that's not the speed. That's the amplitude. I think I'm out of the boundaries in all directions. Yeah. And maybe I need to iterate a bit more. Yeah, it doesn't. I mean, it's still gonna glitch because the sign. The sign is not true, the distance is not a true. As said here, it's not exact. I mean, the repeat, I don't know if it's said somewhere, but. It's not really said clearly, but yeah, the repeat on edges have a problem. Unless your objects are actually touching exactly at the same on the same plan, you are going likely to have troubles like this one, which in my case is a bit problematic if I want to make a nice effect like that. But I could solve it by what? I mean, by making it smaller, but then... Oh, actually, I can draw lines. I can draw the edges themselves. Yeah, I can do that. Okay. I like the fact the camera is actually not... What do you say? Like the rays are going not in the same, are not parallel, are not going in the same axis. They are actually spreading, meaning on the edge, we see, we actually see the object are like visually touching the other because it's actual 3D. I think by changing that parameter, you actually change that. Yeah, you actually change the I don't know the name the term in a but yeah, that's nice. Okay, What's going to be interesting is I don't rotate my I don't rotate my the whole world. I only rotate individual objects because I do the modulus first, still on my plan, and then for each object doing a rotation. So I don't know, I don't think I want to use the same time or whatever, but maybe a bit. I think the amplitude could be small. Just want to give a what? Oh, is it really the? Yeah, yeah, it's not. It shouldn't multiply the matrix itself. It should multiply the amplitude of the wave of the cos and sine. Nice. So yeah, I want to have the camera moving a bit around so we can see it's 3D. We can make it more. I like to see the far, the far away. Probably closer. But yeah, that's still easy stuff. I mean, yeah, it's just a basic grid of objects. Nothing really fancy. I don't know. The thing is, if you want to make an infinite animation, you will want to split the object. That will be interesting. What can I do with this Ruelo triangle? I don't know if I can make it mess with. Ah, can I actually write a function that will? No, it's not easy. I would love to mess a bit with that, trying to see if such object, if I scale it on the Y, will the curve, obviously the curve will go out, but if I just scale the X and Y, then it's going in, because the curve will have to go back inside. But that's maybe fine. Yeah, let's see how it could look like. Alright, let's save that somewhere. Why do I add a V? I don't need it. Let's just undo that. Go back to the initial shape. I want to keep my nice rotation to see what I'm doing. Make it bigger for now. I want to make a version where I will split in four. I will split my big shape in four pieces, and then that means in terms of animation maybe the four shapes are centered at the same place, and then they are moving away at the same time their edge are going down. But what else? What next? What will happen at the end? Okay, let's play. Let's play with that. The problem is I don't have a way to do opacity. The remarching is, I use the basic one. I don't have But if I just play with intersections, I can see when the objects are splitting. And if I want to do that, it's gonna be the same math. It's gonna be the same. And that's actually an interesting fact. The center of the spheres are the edges, and are also the, I mean, that's the ABC. Meaning the animation I want to do is itself a real triangle, maybe. With an offset, okay. So it's like the sphere function itself. We cannot do that, but I want to make a function, pass a function, and I will use the same formula, I think. Except I don't want to do an intersection. So anyway, let's work that. And let's. Is it the edge? Yeah, that's the edge. Yeah, the edge is the edge of the sphere. The edge of the whole thing is the edge of the sphere. So I can literally go there. Say that it's I don't know what you call it, but another shape. Why do I need? Oh yeah, because that's part of this. Oh, yeah, I need to offset that because I didn't do it inline in all places, but I could have just done the math here. Anyway, that's fine. Now what? Okay, so let's start with something. I want to diverge it. So initially it will be the shape and it's gonna diverge. So I am just gonna scale that every part. Is this going to work? Or do I need to? I don't know. That will work if the normalized vector will be. The length will be the same, I think. But no, it's fine. It's proportional, I guess. Okay. Yeah. How do I call that? It's not nice to have S. Diverge. And edge will be reversely, like the reverse of the diverse. I mean, one minus the diverse. That could be interesting. Let's see. I'm doing an intersection. I want to do an union. Whoops. It's not gonna diverge. It's gonna fully diverge. It's gonna be the same shape. No, it's not gonna be the same shape. The same shape is a zero. Yeah. All right, we are getting somewhere. Just gonna make it smaller. Not that small. So what does this look like? It's the Zelda force, yeah. that's actually what was my plan, so it's gonna look like a Zelda force. It's gonna split like that maybe, and why I am rotating that way? It's not. I don't see anything. Is it the? Oh, because I have a center that is not the actual initial one. Oh, initially that. I do it on Z. Okay. I mean that's okay. The Z need to rotate Z. So it's here. maybe no, not z. Yeah, x. So x plan, the x axis need to rotate to be on the right pi. Not. Yeah, I think no, pi is gonna be too much. Anyway, pi is 3, so 3 point. Let's say 1.3. That's gonna be around that. 1 point. Okay. It's too much. All right. Maybe it should be static. You know. I don't know. It should be static. But that's gonna be the full. You can still animate like globally. But I can just make it static for now. Too much, 7. Ah no, not actually not enough. I'm still confused why it's not centered. It's not centered at all. Not centered on Z. That's weird because that's the same formula, but I don't get it. I don't really get it, to be honest. See, actually it's centered. It is centered, actually. Oh yeah, that's part of, I guess that's part of the fact. Oh yeah, that's what we see in this animation. It's actually not, it's not gonna touch the box as we, so that's a property that exists on in 2D, but in 3D it's not gonna be contained strictly in a box. I guess that's why. It's, yeah. Due to the Ford shape. I don't know if my objects are touching. Sounds like they are touching. But not one of the triangle, I think. I don't know. It's hard to visualize. It's hard to. Oh, I see one of them is touching and one is not, like this one is inside, this one, like the one here, I think it's inside that one, yeah, it's touching too much and, yeah, maybe we have wrong formula. Alright, let's make it better. Let's make it more shiny, more animated. Let's try to make it split. So, let's just try a basic fractional part of the time. So that's a modulus one. F. It's not gonna be enough. It's gonna do that. Splitting. But now, what if I do that as well? But my one minus. Oh yeah, okay, it's doing I think I should do that. But it's not really gonna, it's not looping, but I just wanted to check, and that's the intuition I had, is that if you just it's not like the triangle. Triangle is fine. You would you can make a triangle inside triangle, like the that's always gonna touch the edge. There's no problem in that that shape can be infinitely done, and it's always going to touch. For this shape, it's not the case. For the Reuleaux triangle, because if you split the thing in half, I mean in one third, the curve is going to go back to the what should I do? It's an interesting effect, but it's not looping, it's not... I think instead of mean, using a smooth union will be nice. Maybe diverging a bit further could be an idea. I think this is scaling too much. We can tweak that, but still not gonna do an infinite thing. It should just stay the same. And let's say they just initially are here, they're joining, merging, and what else? What's next? Yeah, I don't know. Still interesting. Shouldn't. It's interesting to put triangle itself inside that. Yeah, it's not centered. I don't get it. Oh yeah, that's what we said, it's like... it's working in 2D but not in 3D in fact. Yeah, I will have to offset that. Anyway, but if it's zero, it's gonna be the same, right? No, it's not. Oh yeah, I'm moving them all. Actually, I shouldn't move. That was done. Maybe it should. Yeah, the whole thing is offsetting. That should be part of that because I diverge. Yeah, that's why. Alright, so why? Just gonna forward that. Y and Z are removing that. All right. Ah, shit, I'm moving. That's minus. Let's make it a plus. Yeah, it's not easy to read at the end, but anyway, it's gonna do the work. Still not the case, that's weird. It is. Yeah. Alright. Yeah, that's because of the shape itself. So now it's centered. It's better centered. I don't know where I'm going with that. I already spent 2 hours in this stream. Should try things faster next time, but it's not easy. Stop rotating like crazy, I cannot see anything. Nice. Like the one inside is going down. But what will that mean? It's not enough diverging, it's stopping too fast. First of all, it's too fast. And it's annoying for the eye to have a cut. That's why I think it's better to use cosinus and just... I'm just lazy, I'm just gonna smooth step because I can project to that. Oh, yeah, that's just a laziness. Why? Why? Minus, no, that's 0 to 1. Okay, yeah, and multiply. Why does it feel there is a rotation? There is no rotation that moves with the time. I don't get it. Still cool though. But I think my divergence is wrong. It's not centered. I think it's producing that effect, no? Oh no, because it's moving on the Z, I guess. Or is it because my triangle itself is actually pushing and okay, that's interesting anyway. I think it's good to, like with some music, do like faster, you know, jumping like that. It's interesting. But it's... Something should be faster. If it's going out... formula I put here. It's like the thing of merging, but that's not really... Should split? And then with some rotation. No. Why is it's not horizontal? Hold on. Yeah, so yeah, okay, I guess that's the rotation is creating the why is it moving up? Yeah, that's again the same problem with that shape is it's not symmetrical, yeah, I mean, need to move it. I mean, on the X, on the Y, plus, minus. It's not the object, it's, yeah, it's, the problem is it's not the same object that is splitting, it's still interesting, it's like a bad a base for something interesting. Okay, so I think what could be interesting is we first start like this. You have the whole object, the hollow. Actually, we should not call it triangle. It's not a triangle. It's I will just call it hollow. We have that shape, the hollow, and it's splitting. And then you have a rotation that makes the one of the split the initial object itself, which is going to split again and again and again. So I think that will make a loop, and then maybe an interesting one. But I will need to figure out the rotation. So split, rotate, and back to initial state where it continues splitting. So meaning we do not want cosinus anymore, we want our fract back, but it needs to be looped and it's too fast. I don't know if anyone is still here, that's like 2 hours in a stream like that. I just wonder if that's like that's just compensating the center but just really, I think it's related to that rotation anyway. It's whoa, that's nice. Split and that's it. Yeah, we could split, we could rotate like that. Split, yeah. But will it really do the initial state? Yeah. That means I need to rotate on the around the final position of my split, and I don't know which one I will take as a base, but I might just mess with the numbers and just try to figure it out. Is this really control? Is this going to offset the center? No, okay, that's fine. That's nice because that's my camera and I can move. No, actually, it's not working. It's not gonna be center. Okay, why not? Is it pi divided by 2, by 3, by the way? Does that make the middle moving nicely? And if I get closer, is this going to show you the shape? So like the overall, I don't know if the effect is going, because I'm gonna have issues with the math, like depending on the camera distance, it's not gonna be the exact same position of the shape when I rotate. So yeah, that would be a factor. Alright, so I need to work in two steps. First step is splitting. Then we have a rotation, and that's it. So, there's two phases. Phase one, we need that effect. Phase two, we need the rotation. I will use F. That's the phase one. It's not F, PH. That's a phase one. Phase one is a splitting. Oops. What just happened? Right. And phase two is the rotation. Yeah, it's not gonna be that. It's gonna be split in two components. Okay. Phase one. Move from 0 to 1. So need to stop at 1. Need to start at 1. That's just a factor T1, T2. Yeah, I was just modelizing T1. Okay, I mean that's phase one is the rotation. Phase one is the divergence, the spread, whatever. Phase two needs to be a rotation. Rotation with P around the, let's try on the X axis, which is already that one. I think I need to rotate up to, I don't know what. And let's actually try another, okay, that's the other way. And that means it's the center that like. Oh yeah, because of this one, I think. Oh. I don't really know why, and I guess I have an offset to take into account somewhere. That's that. Anyway, that's just gonna do a rotation. Split, rotate. Split, rotate. So, to make it work, we need to position that object at the same initial place it was at the beginning. Meaning, I need to do a translation. No, it does not have the same size. I need to do a translation, a scale. Or I can just trick some in some way. But, oh. Yeah, that's interesting. Anyway. Moving on X. What would happen if I try to do that? I need to make it faster because I cannot. Yeah, that seems like it's okay. It's better to find the factor. Yeah, nice. But it's like it's not finished. We miss something. I'm still gonna see the other objects, that's a problem, man. I'm not moving at the correct place, neither. And maybe this will all change if I change my camera, so yeah, that's a bit tricky. Yeah, we can see the translation is not good, it's moving. But it's needed. Lost in rotations. That's missing everything. So we can see it that way. Let's forget about rotations first. Except I just have a pretty bad rotation initially, so now my thing is moving half. I guess something like half of the edge of the 8 of the whole shape. So I need to move back that object. Because actually it does not scale. It does not scale. It's still a 2. It's always a 2. So I just need to move it back. Rotate, move it back at the same time. Move it back to what? And I'm a bit. It's never easy to. In this paradigm, you know, like rotations, then translations. Should you translate first and rotate, or should it be the reverse? Because the P is going to change the. Yeah. So, anyway, we can figure it out. It sounds like it didn't finish this rotation. Maybe it needs more. No, it's that. Oh, wait. I need to rotate by 90 degrees, in fact. No? That's where I'm confused. That's that's 45 degrees. Is this going to be... Is this going to be enough? Is this... Sounds like he didn't finish this whole session. He needed a bit more. And that part I don't really get. Why? And what's interesting is I'm just rotating it back to the previous coordinate. I mean the previous rotation, so that means I should be back to that. Oh no, I did a translation here. What? Ah, okay, that's why. My god, that's annoying. I'm too low for the camera to look like okay. So yeah, that's... I think that's the problem with the camera, the fact it's not a orthogonal camera. It's actually spreading. Yeah, I would have to mess with that if I want to. But I think it's better if it's not orthogonal, otherwise. It's harder, but it's better. I need to reverse whatever I do, basically. I think it needs to be before. Wait a minute. If I do this and I rotate back, is this going to be the same? It's a no op, right? Yeah. Oh my god, I think that's why. Is this moving from 0 to 1? Yes. Modulus T. Yeah. I mean, if I mess with that, I don't know if it's... Like, will that be the exact position? Yeah, I don't know. Like... Will that work? We are always going to see the other objects, and that's the problem. But I'm diverging too far again, like here, it's... And if I don't... Thank you. it's all a matter of perspective. That's a problem. It's all a matter of perspective. There is no way I'm gonna get the same perspective. And I'm still gonna see the object. So anyway, that was quite interesting. I think I'm gonna finish soon. And just gonna ship whatever I have, even though it's really not... It's not reaching the what I wanted to reach. Maybe I'm gonna continue a bit tonight. Anyway, that was it. That was still a lot of fun. I think next time I want to make it a bit faster, probably a bit, I think I should stick at least in 2 hours, maybe less, and I need to probably get more ideas ready before and get more, get a bit faster, if I can manage to get it a bit faster. But yeah, this was a bit a discovery for me to try to implement that Relo. Was still fun. I guess we'll continue that series in a week, and I'm gonna continue writing shaders a bit every day and publish them. Thanks a lot if you watched so far, and have a good evening and a good weekend. Bye.